Welcome to the ACE webinar, Model-Informed Precision Dosing, with a special focus on antipsychotics and antibiotics. My name is Birgit Koch. I'm a hospital pharmacist, clinical pharmacologist, and an associate professor in clinical pharmacometrics. This is part of the ACE Pharmacology and Therapeutics. A couple of years ago, we made a word cloud, all of these subjects which can be included in this ACE. And as you can see, a lot of subjects can be included. Pharmacology and therapeutics for sure, but also respiratory disease, neglected disease, biomarkers, therapeutic drug monitoring, PK/PD. All of these subjects are part of the ACE Pharmacology and Therapeutics. And in this next slide, you can see that lots of departments are also already included in this ACE. Clinical chemistry, internal medicine, emergency departments. If you see this webinar and you think, okay, I can also want to be a part of this ACE, please join our ACE. We are happy to include you in our ACE. All of our patients in the Erasmus Medical Center, they're all different. We have patients which are have different weights. We have patients which are small adults. We have patients who are on renal replacement therapy or other devices. Patients who are on intensive care, but also patients who are older. And all of these patients have different patient characteristics. Problem is that most of the dosing of the drugs has been developed with young male adults. And so these are not the patients we normally see in a hospital. This makes that we see a lot of adverse events, but also that the dosing is not correct. So the efficacy of the drug is not correct. And we can do better. And that's what my research line is about. It's about model-informed precision dosing. We use a lot of characteristics of patients, and these are all combined in a model. So we have all of the factors which are in the model. Then we make a model. You can see on the left part of the slide, we want to validate the model with data from the model, but also from an external database. And at the end, we want to make an algorithm you can use to individualize a dose and to use this algorithm in clinical practice. And the outcome will be that there's precision dosing for all patients. So if you're an adult or if you're a child, your dosing will be more optimized and you will have less side effects and a better efficacy of your treatment. So how do we make these models? As I already told you, we use all of the characteristics patients have. And this is called pharmacometric modeling. In pharmacometric modeling, you use characteristics of patients, drug characteristics, but also patient characteristics like demographic characteristics, and all of them are combined in a model. So the basis is pharmacometrics. We use pharmacokinetics, pharmacodynamics, we use pharmacogenetics, and at the end, we want to optimize and individualize the dose of a patient. So what is these pharmacometric modeling? First of all, pharmacokinetics is important. With pharmacokinetics, you have different processes in your body, and all of them are combined in what your body does to the drug. So for sure, in the beginning, you have absorption of the drug. Then it goes to the distribution part. So it's the drug is distributed through the body. Then we have metabolism. Most often it's a part in the liver. Then the drug is metabolized. And this is most often done because the drug needs to be more hydrophilic. So it's metabolized to a hydrophilic part, and then it can be eliminated via the kidney. And all of these processes together, they are called ADME, or pharmacokinetics. And I think it's very important that if you have a patient, then you know, okay, the patient is probably older, so it has a different pharmacokinetic profile than the younger patient. And these characteristics all have to be combined in our pharmacokinetic model. After our pharmacokinetics, we have pharmacodynamics. That means what the drug does to the body. So if the drug has an antibiotic effect or if it has an analgesic effect, all of these factors play a role in how your body reacts to the drug. And I think it's important to know what kind of variations a patient has and how he reacts to a drug. For example, an older patient can have a different reaction on analgesic drugs in comparison to a younger patient. And these aspects have to be combined if you want to have a more precision dosing. So together, pharmacodynamics and pharmacokinetics make a PK/PD model, and these factors can make a dosing algorithm, and this dosing algorithm can be used in the pharmacometric model and can be used in clinical practice to have a best dose for all of the patients. So the intensive care patient has a different dose than the neonatal patient or the older patient or the patient on dialysis. All of these factors are important and they are needed in the algorithm. If we have the PKPD model, you find a therapeutic window, which means this is a window in which the dose has to be titrated, and you get a certain level, most often in blood, having a threshold, meaning that you need enough level that you have an effect, but also that your level shouldn't be too high because then you have side effects. These are called the therapeutic window of a drug. And the other term is also therapeutic drug monitoring. And we need therapeutic windows and therapeutic drug monitoring to actually use the PK/PD models in our clinical practice. So we have the therapeutic window, we have the PK/PD model, we have the algorithm, and afterwards we have the therapeutic window we use in our clinical practice. So we have the conditions of a patient, we have the adverse therapeutic effects, we have the narrow therapeutic effects, and we also know that we can monitor and detect the drug. This is often done in a lab, for example, a chromatography lab or a mass spectrometry lab. We measure in blood the concentration, and then we adjust the concentration based on the therapeutic window found in our PK/PD model. And this is done in a lab, and in the future we want to also use it in biosensors at the point of care at a patient's its bed. So examples of model precision dosing, I want to show you a couple of things we have done in the last years. One of them is the understanding the alternate and variable physiology of intensive care patients. We have critical ill patients. They have a variable pharmacokinetics, so they have a hypodynamic status, they have increased cardiac output and increased clearance. They most often have an altered fluid balance, leading to an increased volume of distribution. They have renal or hepatic impairment, resulting in increased volume of distribution and also in a reduced clearance of the drug. And sometimes you see renal replacement therapy, for example, dialysis or ECMO, this resulting in an increased volume distribution and leading to increased clearance. All of these things happen in an intensive care patient. This will result in a variability in antibiotic concentration, and not only in antibiotic concentration, but also in other drugs. But in this project, we focused on antibiotics. We have subtherapeutic antibiotic concentrations, and probably we have therapeutic failure, treatment failure, or leading to a therapeutic resistance, so antibiotic resistance. And this is what we don't want to have in these critical ill patients. So a couple of years ago, we wanted to indeed investigate if critical ill patients indeed had too low antibiotic levels. That's why we did the expert study. The expert study is a study in 175 patients. Most of them were male. And we collected 1,000 blood samples of these patients. And these are the drugs we measured. All of them are antibiotics, both beta-lactam antibiotics, but also ciprofloxacin, which is a different kind of antibiotic. The study was performed in the Erasmus Medical Center, but also in the Maastad Hospital in Rotterdam. And what did we find? This is the pharmacodynamic target, which means that the drug is well dosed. And this is patients, so for ciprofloxacin, only in 16% of the patients, the target was reached. So most of the patients did not have a correct target, so they were undertreated, and this can lead to failure, but also can lead to antibiotic resistance. In the other group, these were the beta-lactam antibiotics, 60% of the patients reached their pharmacodynamic target, so I think we can improve. And this was actually the result of the expert study. So after the study, we started the Dolphin study. And the Dolphin trial is a dose individualization of antibiotics in intensive care patients to TDM, so to therapeutic drug monitor or not, and the effects on outcome. And it's a multi-center prospective randomized study using active TDM, so active blood sampling and active measurement of the antibiotic concentrations, and afterwards correcting the dose if the level was not good enough, versus just doing what we did before, so just standard dosing. And the study population are adult intensive care patients with standard antibiotic therapy, and the objective was early adjustment of dose by means of TDM, resulting in a very important clinical outcome shorter intensive care stay. And that was our main focus. And we actually are at the moment quite happy because we're now at number 405. So almost completed. We need 450 patients to be included in this study. And I think we're almost there. So these are the hospitals we actually include our patients in. And as you can see, there are lots of hospitals. So it's an interesting study. It's also resulting in lots of logistic problems, but I think that's something for another webinar. But I think it's very good that we almost reach our inclusion and that in a couple of years, we can show our results and we can see if indeed therapeutic drug monitoring will lead in better dosing of patients on the intensive care with regards to antibiotics. And the study is actually funded by a couple of organizations. Another study we did is precision dosing of antipsychotics in children with autism. Children with autism can have behavioral problems, and sometimes they can be so bad that they need antipsychotics to actually relieve the behavioral problems. That can be important for the children, but also for the parents who actually have a child with autism. And there are certain drugs which are given. These are called antipsychotics, and the three most used are risperidone, aripiprazole, and bipamperone. The problem is that they are very effective, but they also have a lot of side effects. And if you treat 10 patients with antipsychotics, two of them will have a lot of weight gain. And sometimes that can even go up to 10 kilograms, which in a child can be a lot. And at the end, this will lead to a metabolic syndrome, but also to diabetes. And this is quite a large problem in our patient population. And I think we can do better. So that's why a couple of years ago, we started with this study to have more precision dosing of antipsychotics in these children. So this is called the SPACE study. And the SPACE study is a study on the safety and effectivity of antipsychotics in children. This was carried out in a couple of centers in the Netherlands, the Southwest Netherlands. And what did we do? You can see our PhD student Sanne on the right side. She did a study in which we measured the concentration of the drug. And we did not do this with the classical form. So we did not do this with venipuncture, but we did this with dried blood spots, which means that you can prick the finger of a patient. As a couple of blood drops, you can put it on a paper, it can be dried, and it can be sent to the laboratory. This makes it easy because then the patient can actually do it at home, which is much more patient-friendly, and also the patients who are patients, so they are children with autism, it's much easier for them to do it at home than to go to a hospital and have a doctor performing it. So that was quite an advantage of the study. We measured the dry blood spot, and we also measured the efficacy and also the side effects of our patients to see if indeed we can find a therapeutic window, finding a dose which makes it better, makes the dose more effective, but also having less side effects, having less weight gain, and also having less diabetes at the end. So what we found, and you can see this on the blue-green window, there is indeed a therapeutic window. There is a window in which the patient has an effective dose, but also that he has less side effects. So he has less weight gain. And the next couple of years, we're going to do this study. We're actually going to continue with a therapeutic drug window study, in which we're going to call SPACE to STAR, in which indeed we're going to find out if this algorithm we found with the PK/PD model used in the SPACE will lead to better dosing and also to less side effects. So that's a nice outcome of this study. And the other thing we found with pipamperone, which is another drug, is that there is indeed better dosing can be performed. And this is actually now in the Dutch kinderformulaire. So we also implemented the results we found in our SPACE study. And I think that is a very important feature of this model-informed precision dosing. It's not about making models, but it's about using this algorithm and better dosing of patients and also implementing these algorithms in clinical practice. And this is actually the most important slide, that we next couple of years, we're not going to go from giving standard dosing and then doing therapeutic drug monitoring. So this is the higher part of the graph, but going to the lower part, which means you can have a patient with a diagnosis, then you can have a dose based on the PK/PD model, the algorithm we found in clinical practice, and then we're going to measure the dose of a patient, and then we're going to adopt to actually get a better dosing at the end. So to start with the PK/PD model algorithm and then continue and make the model even better and also make the patient getting a better precision dosing. After we found the model, we want to implement it in our clinical practice. So we just recently got a fund in which we're going to make dashboards and use the models we found and implement them in dashboards for the physician, but also implement our models in the hospital system so that if a patient comes to a physician, the physician can just say, okay, this is the patient, these are the characteristics of the patients, this is the model I want to use, and then actually the dose of a patient is getting individualized at the beginning, and then you can get a better treatment from the beginning. And I think this will lead to a better effective dose, but also to less side effects. So to summarize my presentation, I hope I informed you on the positive aspects of model-informed precision dosing. And what we can do with models, we can use them to implement all of the patient characteristics, the disease characteristics, and also the drug characteristics, making a pharmacometric model and making algorithm to actually get a better precision dosing of antibiotics in this presentation, but also antipsychotics in children with autism. And I think I showed you some nice results of our research. And I also showed you how to implement them in clinical practice. And I think we have a lot to do in this field the next couple of years. I think it's important that in all of these ACE webinars that collaboration is important. We have an ACE with a lot of departments. And I think that working together, you can have better results. So I think a nice infrastructure and a network is very important in these ACEs. And I think the pharmacology and therapeutic is a nice example how to work together and how to get better precision dosing of drugs. I think 1 and 1 is 3, I think that is a very important slogan in this field. And then I want to now give the word to Sinno Simons, who is my colleague, neonatologist, and he's going to talk about mother and child pharmacology. And the other one is a PhD student, a pharmacist. Her name is Laura Peeters, and she's going to talk about therapeutic drug monitoring and hypertension, also the effects of therapeutic drug monitoring on adherence. And I think it's very good that to show you some more ideas how precision dosing can be improved. So thank you very much for listening to this webinar. If you have further questions, please you can see my email address, and I hope to see you again. Thank you.
My name is Sinno Simons. I'm a neonatologist, clinical pharmacologist within the Erasmus MC Medical Center, Sophia Children's Hospital. And today I'm going to present about mother and child pharmacology and why this is such an important issue within the ACE of pharmacology. Many of the drugs that are used during pregnancy, but also the drugs that are used after birth in case of, for instance, preterm born children or children that are critically ill after birth, many of these drugs are not registered for use during pregnancy, lactation, or use in early infancy. And that is why we need to study these pharmacological strategies. Many of the drugs that are used are not used registered, and we need to improve their use to have a better perinatal and neonatal outcome. That is where one of the focuses is of our research within the ACE. We try to improve the currently used drugs by getting improved dosing, but also we are looking for individualized dosing. But next to the already used drugs, we need to search for new therapies to improve this outcome as stated before. For instance, we should study new drugs that lead to neuroprotection or lung protection in the infants, but probably even more important, we can also search for studies and drugs that prevent preterm birth, improve pregnancy outcome, and in the end, provide a better health of our patients. For this, developmental pharmacology is of utmost importance. We need to understand how pharmacology changes during life, during pregnancy, but also, for instance, after birth. And after birth, issues like excretion, metabolism, but also distribution of drugs completely differs within the first weeks of life. The kidneys get more active. The liver starts to metabolize the drugs much faster within the first weeks, and the body composition of an infant changes dramatically during the first period of life. Altogether, this means that drugs and drug dosing should be adapted according to gestational age, to body weight, but also to postnatal age, and we need to search for doses that are specific based on your gender too. In this slide, I show you an example of fentanyl. Fentanyl is an opioid used for severe pain as an analgesic in our infants. And this graphic shows you the difference that is found in the clearance of fentanyl in infants with a different gestational age. So you see that the clearance increases with gestational age, but also a dramatic increase with the postnatal age. And you can understand, if you see this figure, that the dose of fentanyl needs to be changed according to your postnatal age, but also to your gestational age at birth. Another example of a drug that has been studied in our wards is ibuprofen, that is used to close the ductus arteriosus after birth. And in this graphic again, you see the difference in clearance of the drug. It depends importantly on gestational age, but also it is dramatically different for infants that are born small for gestational age. So for this drug, the dose needs to be adapted to gestational age, to postnatal age, but also to weight. And so in this way, we get more individualized dosing dependent on the maturation of the drug for each individual patient. Coming back to the presentation that was given before me, where all the different factors that are important in pharmacology, they need to be added to this issue of developmental pharmacology. So next to the maturation of the patient itself, again, all these factors that are important in pharmacology need to be added to the patient needs. So the individual dosing of a patient not only depends on the maturation of the patient, but also, for instance, on the body weight, if the patient is critically ill, if there is severe inflammation, if the kidneys are working well, and also very important, they might also be determined by the genetic makeup of the patient itself. And taking all these issues together, we can come to more individualized dosing of drugs. Two examples of important drugs that are currently studied by our groups in the SOFIA are doxepram and pentoxifilin. Doxepram is a drug that is used off-label in our hospital and that has been studied for years by us. We already did retrospective analysis and we studied the PK of the drug, and in that way we came to an optimized dosing. And currently we are coordinating a large international randomized controlled trial to also study the effectiveness and the safety of this drug on the long-term perspective. And another good example of a new drug that has been introduced in our wards is pentoxifilin. This is a xanthine derivative that is added to antibiotics in the case of severe late-onset sepsis of preterm newborns. And this drug, if you add it to the antibiotics, improves the outcome of the infant. But although this drug is already used in our wards, no one ever studied the optimal dosing. And that's what we are doing in a current ongoing clinical trial. In this way, we more and more try to understand how we should dose drugs in very specific groups of patients, for instance, the preterm born infants. The next step, however, can be made by combining this knowledge on developmental pharmacology with technical knowledge. And that is probably the way Erasmus Medical Center will go in the next years. What is already available is continuous data on the physiological monitoring of the patients in our wards. Every patient gets a heart rate, a blood pressure, an oxygen saturation, etc., measured every second. And we are currently able to get these data available on the bedside. So we can reanalyze these data and continuous data, we can combine them with the data on drug exposure. So if you add the physiological data of the patients together with the drug dosing of the patient, and you can even simulate here what is available on the individual exposure, if you simulate that, you can much better understand how a drug is working in the individual and what happens if you adapt the dose. And in that way, I think unique opportunities will cross our path in the upcoming years, because we can much better evaluate the effect and side effect of a drug in an individual patient. we can see if the drug that has been started was efficient, and we can go to a much better individualized and optimized therapy. In that way, we go from a subjective evaluation, as is currently still the state of the art, and a standardized dosing for all groups of patients, to a more objective evaluation using the continuous monitor data, and to an individualized dosing to get a much better efficacy and less side effects in our patients. And this is a way where research and clinical care come together and improve the outcome of our patients. As a final part of my presentation, I want to show you about a unique collaboration within the Erasmus Medical Center. During the last year, we have created a placenta lab. This lab is a collaboration of the Department of Obstetrics, the Department of Pediatrics and the Division of Neonatology, and the Department of Pharmacology. And in our hospital, we have many deliveries. And these deliveries are healthy pregnancies, but also complicated pregnancies where the baby is already delivered at preterm age or at term age with certain complications. And this provides us unique material. All these placentas can be taken to the laboratory and to the placenta lab, where we have facilities to test the placenta ex vivo. And in this way, we can determine the pharmacokinetics of certain drugs that are already used, but also study the pharmacokinetics of drugs that have never been used during pregnancy. And next to the pharmacokinetics, where we are very thankful to the pharmacy that always is able to measure the drug levels in the fetal and maternal side, we can also study the effects of the drugs itself and see if they may provide the new therapies that provide the future for our mothers and children in our hospital. And with that, I hope that I have convinced you about the importance of pharmacology during pregnancy, but also during the neonatal life and early infancy. This is an important focus of our hospital, and I truly hope that in the next years, this will be even broader and better in our hospital. And thank you very much for your attention, and I hope to convince you about this topic. Thank you very much.
Welcome, everybody. I'm glad to see that you all tuned in to learn more about the ACE pharmacology and therapeutics. My name is Laura Peeters, and I'm a fourth-year PhD candidate at the Hospital Pharmacy Department and Internal Medicine Department. And today I will talk about the sense or nonsense of therapeutic drug monitoring in hypertension. But first, a little bit of background. Well, I think most of you guys will know that when you have hypertension or uncontrolled hypertension, that will lead to an increased risk of cardiovascular disease and kidney damage. And in consequence of that, those patients are getting more hospitalized, and that will lead to procedures and longer stays in the hospital, and that will lead to more costs. So to prevent all of this, we will want to treat hypertension. Fortunately, we have a lot of antihypertensive drugs to use. And so, in theory, every patient will get the optimal treatment for their hypertension. Also, when we look at the ground rules for therapeutic drug monitoring, or TDM, you can see that antihypertensive drugs will not fit the bill. I pointed that out with two red crosses in the ground rules, and you can see that antihypertensive drugs do not have a narrow therapeutic range, and we can easily measure the efficacy by measuring blood pressure. So why do I want to talk about TDM for antihypertensive drugs? Well, we have two main problems in hypertension. First, non-adherence, so not taking your medicine as prescribed. And the second problem is that one size does not fit all for a hypertension patient. So a lot of patients react differently on antihypertensive drugs. But let's focus on the first problem, non-adherence in hypertension. So if you use a lot of antihypertensive drugs and you don't reach your blood pressure goal, you have so-called resistant hypertension. But when you don't take your medicine as prescribed, so if you are non-adherent, then you have a high blood pressure because you didn't take your medicine. So you have pseudo-resistant hypertension. So that's a really big problem in the hypertension field. Also, it's very hard for physicians to predict the patients that are non-adherent. So we are in need of tools to identify non-adherence, and therapeutic drug monitoring is one of the best tools to identify patients with non-adherence. It is most accurate and most invasive, as you can see in the graph on the slide. But fortunately, we developed a method to do therapeutic drug monitoring, but getting the method less invasive. And we developed a dry blood spot to do this. A dry blood spot is a non-invasive method, so we do that with a finger prick, and we put a drop of blood on a paper, and with that drop of blood, we can measure the drug concentrations in blood. Also, it is really easily to perform. A physician can do it, a patient can do it, so it's very easy. Also, you have immediate sampling, so if the physician suspects that a patient didn't take his medicine, then you can do it right at the doctor's office. Also, we extensively validated this method, so we know that the values we found are the true values, and we can even measure trough levels up until 24 hours after intake of the drug. So a really nice method, and that is why we are using this method in a randomized multi-center controlled trial called RIME-RCT, which stands for Resistant Hypertension Measured to Reach Targets. We are including patients at 11 different hospitals throughout the Netherlands, and we want to focus on the main question: do measuring drug levels combined with personalized feedback lead to a decrease in resistant hypertension after 12 months of follow-up due to improved adherence? So we measure adherence, of course, with our dried blood spot, and on the slide you can see the 12 antihypertensive drugs which we can measure in this method, and we do also do 24-hour blood pressure measurements, which is the most accurate method to measure blood pressure. So as I told you, it is a randomized controlled trial, so we have a control arm and an intervention arm, and in the intervention we tell the physicians if what we found with the dried blood spot, so is the patient adherent or non-adherent. We do not tell the physicians this of the patients that are in the control arm. They're just getting standardized treatment and not anything else towards the outcome of the dry blood spot. Also, when we identify the patients in the intervention group that are non-adherent, the physicians can do a personalized feedback method to try to find out what the reasons are for being non-adherent, and then try to solve this problem. So because of the limited time I have, I only have a slide on predictions of physicians versus our TDM tool. So we asked physicians on forehand if they could estimate which patients were adherent and which patients were non-adherent. And afterwards, I combined those with the outcome from the dry blood spot. And as you can see, these are the predictions of physicians of patients that they thought were therapy adherent. And these are the predictions of patients that they thought were non-adherent. And the dark blue colors are the wrong estimations. So as you can see, in 20% of the case, when the physician thought the patient was non-adherent, the patient was actually non-adherent. And it's even worse for when they thought the patient was non-adherent, they were actually adherent. So in total, almost one third of the patients was wrongly identified. And therefore, I think TDM is a really useful tool to help recognize non-adherence. So let's go to the second problem. So one size does not fit all. This is a really busy table, but here you can see all the drugs we can measure with a dried blood spot. There are 8 different antihypertensive drugs and their active metabolites. And with a dried blood spot, can not only measure qualitative measurements, but also quantitative measurements, quantitative values. And with the qualitative values, we can use that for the adherence. So only is it in the blood or is it not in the blood, but quantitative measures can be used for personalized medicine. And here you can see when we looked at the same dose of these drugs, we saw that the patients with the lowest concentration and the highest concentration had a fold difference between those concentrations of up to 3 to 35 a full change, which is a really big difference, and that means that some of the patients won't have effect of the drugs and some patients would have adverse events. So this is a really big problem. Also, when we looked at certain variables that are of influence on the height of the drug concentration in blood, we identified age as one of the variables that are of influence on the height of the concentration. And I want to focus on these three drugs. So these are the active metabolites of losartan, pirenopril, and spironolactone. They are significant or borderline significant for age, and that means in case of losartan and pirenopril that with increasing age, the plasma concentrations of the drugs will increase, and that would possibly mean that these patients would benefit from lower dosages. But we don't really know if higher concentrations in these elderly patients will lead to lower blood pressures. That is the theory, but we don't know that. So that is why we are conducting a study called Decision, and where we look at if elderly really have higher concentrations compared to younger patients, and if these high concentrations really lead to lower blood pressure. So these are the two objectives that we have, and I think I'd like to focus on the second, that if the concentration will lead to lower blood pressure, that we use the area under the curve of the losartan and pirenopril, and of course we measure this with our dried blood spot method, so with TDM. So at the end of this 10 minutes, I think I can say yes, I think therapeutic drug monitoring in hypertension makes sense. It definitely makes sense to identify non-adherence of to antihypertensive drugs. And I think I also showed you that with quantitative measurements, which we can get with therapeutic monitoring, we go towards a more personalized drug dosing when we combine pharmacokinetics with pharmacodynamics, so concentration versus blood pressure. So I also want to thank the ACE Pharmacology and Therapeutics, my research team, and all the hospitals that are involved in the randomized controlled trial. And if you have any questions, please email me on the email address that's on the slide. Thank you very much.